First, let me thank Dimitri and the organizers for inviting me here. It's my first time in Natal and Brazil, and it's been very nice. So let me start by explaining the philosophy of this ADS applied to condensed matter systems. So essentially, the words people say is that you apply holography to systems that are strongly correlated. That for us, it means just strongly coupled. For people coming from high energy physics. And then that they have no quasi-particle description. Okay. So let me explain a little bit what this means. So suppose we have a system with a free scalar. This will be the action. And then we can compute the retarded correlator for this guy, which is defined just introducing some time order. This is the step function. And then you compute the commutator at different points. Okay. So this is the definition of the retarded correlator, and you can define it for any operator here in the commutator. So let's assume there is translation invariance. So this depends on the difference between these two points. And then we can expand these in plane waves. So for to be concrete, let's assume we are in four dimensions now. But the same applies in any number of dimensions. So this will be the expansion in plane waves. This is the Fourier transform. And for a free theory, this has a simple form that you all know. It's just a pole, well, a double pole. So it will be like this. No? This will be the correlator. Now, I put here plus I epsilon. This epsilon is going to zero from above. And this is the prescription you need to have a retarded correlator. Basically, this is, you look in the complex frequency plane. No? This is real frequencies. And this is imaginary frequencies. Then you are computing this integral over frequencies on a contour which is slightly above the real axis. And then because you're looking at t minus t prime larger than zero, then in order for this to be convergent, you should close the contour below, in the lower half plane. So if there are any singularities in the lower half plane, then they will give a contribution to this integral. Okay, so let me write this correlator in as a sum over poles. So this is a simple exercise. I'm going to define the energy to be square root of k squared plus m squared. And then this is simply 1 over 2 times the energy, and then the sum of two poles. Well, the difference. Okay, so you see you have two poles localized at real values, here at a positive value of the energy, and here you want at the negative value. Okay, so now we can write this in a slightly different way, using the principal value. So there is a part which is just the principal value of these poles, which will be something like this. And notice, just for the record, that this part is even if you send the frequency to minus the frequency. So this is a property when you have time reversal invariance, as we do. And then there is another part which comes of this plus I epsilon, and that gives you some delta functions. Okay. So this tells you more or less what are the physical degrees of freedom that you have. This is captured by the spectral function, which in this case is just minus 2 times the imaginary part of the retarded correlator. Okay, and this will give you just pi over the energy times these delta functions. Okay. So you see the spectral function is odd when you send the frequency to minus the frequency. And the real part was even. So we can focus just on positive frequencies. No? If you plot the spectral function, rho, as a function of the frequency, then at the value of the energy, there is a delta function. It's the spectral function. And this is telling you that there is a particle in this theory which has a dispersion relation with where the frequency equals this energy. No? The frequency as a function of k, of the momentum, equals this energy. Now, let's now modify a little bit this theory. So we introduce some small change in the potential here. For instance, we could introduce a phi cube term, but keeping this coupling small. So this is going to introduce you mean the Feynman correlator, or? Yeah. Yes, if I apply the Klein-Gordon operator, I will get a delta function. Yeah, thanks. So let's modify a little bit the theory, introducing some interactions. If we do that, the propagator, that in the free theory we can represent as a line, will receive corrections. So it will be the free propagator, and then we'll start having diagrams. This will go like g squared, and then you can have g to the 4, something like this, for instance, etc. Okay, so this will modify the propagator. There are other modifications as well, but let's focus on this. And if one resums the contributions, in principle, one can write the contributions from all these diagrams as having some self-energy correction. Okay, so here we will have the energy from the theory at zero coupling, and then there is some correction, which is some function of the frequency and the momentum that appears here when we resum, for instance, diagrams that will be like this, no? Will be a geometric series. Okay, so what is this going to do? So this is we can rewrite this maybe as some new energy that depends on the coupling, and there can be also some imaginary part. Okay. So this is going to change the position of this delta function, and this imaginary part is going to give it a width. So if you now compute the spectral function as a function of the frequency, then you are going to find some kind of peak like this. Okay, and then this size depends on the imaginary part. So it goes like omega, sorry, gamma. Okay, so this is not a particle anymore. If you want, it's not, it doesn't live forever, but you can think of it as a quasi-particle. No? It lives for a long time of the order of one of the width, and then it has some dispersion relation. Sorry? Sorry? Yes, okay, this will be in the case, okay, this I didn't explain completely, but if you are in a many body, if you are in a state which is not the vacuum, but you have some density, then when this particle propagates, it will interact with other particles that are around, and then it will lose its identity. So that will be the situation where you have this quasi-particle. But yeah, or if you add more terms to the axon with other particles, it could decay to the other particles. Yeah. When I do. Well, here's. You can compute the self-energy, and then whether it's Feynman or retarded and so on depends on how you implement the I epsilon prescription. So you compute the 1 PI diagrams. Well, the singularities will be the same. The singularities of the propagators will be the same. It's just how you choose the contour. No, if, I don't know, what is the counter? Here, no? For a Feynman propagator, you will pick this pole, but not that pole, for instance. So it's just how you pick the singularities. But you can compute this for the time order propagator, and then you can find what is the retarded propagator. It's, the singularities will be the same. Okay, so now we can think of, instead of having this simple theory, one has a theory where the fundamental degrees of particle of freedom are interacting with each other, and they can be interacting very strongly. So imagine we have some systems with fermions, and they have very strong interactions. And then we are in a state at finite density, which is a many-body state that is very complicated to describe. But imagine we define some operator, which is psi dagger psi. And then we can define the retarded correlator for this operator in a similar way as we did for the fundamental field. And from here, we can look at the spectral function. So imagine the spectral function for this operator looks something like this. Okay. So then you see that there are some peaks here that will be localized at some position that can depend on the momentum. And then they have some width. So you can approximate the spectral function or the retarded correlator by some pole of this form. Then you can think of describing the system at low energies or low frequencies as a system of quasi-particles with these dispersion relations. Okay, so this will have a quasi-particle description. And then you can try to write an axiom, an effective axiom, that will reproduce this behavior. Okay? Usually, this is not what you do. You write first the effective axiom, and then you compare to observations. But you can do it when this happens, when you have some well-defined quasi-particle peaks. So a system with no quasi-particles will be one where we don't have this kind of structure. Okay, so if we look at the spectral function, it might look something like this. So there is nothing that looks like a quasi-particle peak. Okay, and then trying to write an effective axiom will not be useful because it won't correspond to weakly coupled quasi-particles. Okay, so the idea is that holography or ABS-CFT might be useful to describe this kind of systems. So why is that? Because we know it was successful, for instance, to give some qualitative understanding of the quark-gluon plasma. No? In QCD, at very low temperatures, below the deconfinement transition, you have a system of hadrons. And then you can write an effective axiom for them. For instance, you can write the chiral Lagrangian. No? This is not derived from microscopic physics, but it's based on using the methods of effective field theory. No? You use symmetry, and then you compare to experiments, and you fix the parameters of the axiom. So you have a quasi-particle description, which are these hadrons. If you're at very high temperatures, then you can use the fact that QCD is asymptotically free. And then your quasi-particles are almost like quarks and gluons with some dressing. And you also have a weakly coupled description. But in between, just above the deconfinement transition, there is no description in terms of hadrons or in terms of quarks and gluons. Spectral functions will look like that. And then the usual methods don't work. But ABS-CFT can deal with this kind of strongly coupled systems with no problem in principle. And then you compare and you see that more or less it gives a good description. So the hope is that one can use a holography also for condensed matter systems that have these characteristics as well. Okay, but it's not that you are going to describe a concrete material or anything like that. You just want to derive general properties of systems with no quasi-particle description. Yes, the fact that you have some narrow peaks. No? The picture, if you want, is that this tells you have some kind of propagating degree of freedom, okay, at the location of the peak. And then the width comes, the picture will be the width comes because it collides with other particles in the system. So if the particles are, if the collisions are separated far apart, then this width is small. So this means the particle exists for a relatively long time. But if the collisions are very frequent, then this width is big, and then you don't really see an independent particle propagating. Yes. Yeah, but in the picture where you have particles, this decay, this is a quasi-particle, so it's a collective mode of the system. So it just dissipates, so this tells you how it dissipates. But then you have also this picture of, if you are doing kinetic theory, you have this picture that this dissipation is because of these collisions. Yeah, it was just a picture. Yes, this could be temperature or density, or something that you have some collective motion that are these quasi-particles, and then they can decay. Okay. So this kind of philosophy applies to several systems. And then here I have listed a bunch of reviews and lectures that you can look if you want to go more in detail on the things I will tell in the lectures. So we'll start with the simplest systems. So let's think about ADS-CFT as it was originally formulated. No? Horacio gave us some nice lectures about that. So people started thinking about describing gauge theories as string theories a long time ago, since the paper of Toft in 74, but for QCD it was not successful. However, much later, it was successful for N equals 4, which looks like much more complicated. But in some sense, it's much simpler because it has a lot of symmetry. So especially it has conformal symmetry, which played a crucial role. So then it's natural to start thinking about scaling systems, or systems with some kind of scaling variance in condensed matter. So in general, if you have a random material or whatever, there will be some scales and the system won't have any scale invariants. But you can adjust some parameters, magnetic field, doping, pressure, and then you can put the system in some critical point where there is a scale invariance or correlation lengths diverge. No? So the typical example is when you have when you have temperature and magnetization in some magnetic material, then above some critical temperature, the Curie temperature, there is no magnetization. And then if you lower the temperature, a magnetization appears, you have a magnet. And at this point, you have a critical point. So here, this is characterized because there is a correlation length that diverges at the critical point. And you can also have some characteristic time for correlations, which is related to the correlation length by some dynamical exponent set. Okay, so for instance, this will appear if you compute a space-like separated correlators, then they will decay exponentially with a distance with this correlation length. And then if you look at time-dependent fluctuations, they will decay with this characteristic time. Now, at this point, you can have a scale invariance, which you have seen before in the lectures of Horacin, where you rescale time with this dynamical exponent and a space with exponent one, for instance. No? And this is usually called a Monash Lipschitz scaling. Now, critical points at finite temperature are quite well understood. They are classical systems in some sense. But you can also have this kind of behavior at zero temperature. And these are the ones that people now is more interested in. So, let me mention two of them. One is called atoms at unitarity. Okay. So in this case, you have a bunch of atoms, which are fermions, at very low temperatures of order of microkelvin. And then they have an interaction that can look, if you look at the potential versus the separation between atoms, two atoms, the potential may look something like this. Okay. So it's short range, but it's weakly attractive. Okay. So in principle, this attraction makes the two atoms form a Cooper pair, and this is a BCS state. This will be the Cooper pair. Now, you can change this potential by changing the magnetic field. So you can make this potential go down, and then you can form here a bound state. So if the fermions form a bounded state, you have a boson, and this boson can have Bose-Einstein condensation. And then you have the bounded state. And then there is Bose-Einstein condensation. Okay. So there is a crossover between these two situations as you change the magnetic field. And at least for the S-wave case, where this happens in a way which is invariant under rotations. Now, there is a point where this bound state has exactly zero energy. Okay, this is the situation where you are separating these two phases, if you want, although there is no phase transition here. And when this happens, the cross-section becomes maximal for the S-wave. So this means that you saturate the unitarity bound. So when you're at threshold, you saturate the unitarity bound. And this means that the scattering length diverges. Okay, so here you have that this scattering length goes to infinity. Okay, so this is similar to the phase transition I was explaining there. And when this happens, the system becomes scale invariant. There is only one scale, which is the density of atoms you have. And yes. Yeah, it's like the phase of the scattering matrix gets the one corresponding to the maximal value. Yes. So in this case, you have a scale invariance. And the only dimensionful quantity is the density. Okay. So you can write all the observables in the theory using the scale invariance and this density. Now, there are still some dimensionless numbers which are non-trivial and you have to compute. But in principle, the behavior of the energy density and so on is trivial. So this is one kind of scale invariant systems. Yeah. Because this correlation length diverges, and then the only scale is the... How do you know that? Well, that will be a bit long to explain, but you have a... You can describe this system as non-relativistic fermions with some four-fermion coupling. Okay, and then you see that this four-fermion coupling, when you are at this point, becomes marginal. And then the system has some non-relativistic conformal invariance. So, but that will be a bit long to explain. Sorry? Yes, but when you have this state at threshold, the scattering length in the S channel diverges. Sorry? Yeah. Yeah, so this goes to infinity. Yeah, this goes to infinity at the unitarity point. You scatter through this channel. You scatter. I can discuss with you later this if you want, but let me go on. So let's talk about quantum critical points. So this is more similar to the ordinary critical points, except they happen at zero temperature. So what you do is you tune all some other parameter like chemical potential, magnetic field, and so on. And then quantum fluctuations produce a phase transition. So one example, you can have a system of spins, and then let's suppose you have an antiferromagnet, so all the spins are anti-order. You could also have a ferromagnet. And then what you do is you introduce a magnetic field, which is in the horizontal direction. So you introduce some transverse magnetic field, so in this direction. Okay, and this makes the spin want to align in the horizontal direction, but the Hamiltonian, they had without the magnetic field, wants them to be anti-aligned. So there is a competition between these two things. And then if the magnetic field is really strong, then you end with some paramagnet. where the spins don't have any particular orientation. Okay. And between these two faces, there is a separation by a quantum critical point. So if I plot this, this will be the magnetic field. You have the antiferromagnet here. You have the paramagnet here. And here you have the quantum critical point that separates the two faces. So typically, you are in any of these two faces, you will have some quasi-particle description. Excitations will be gap around the ground state. And then these excitations, you can think of them as some quasi-particles with some energy. At the quantum critical point, you don't have any quasi-particle description. And this is the kind of system we are interested in describing. So here, you can now increase the temperature in this diagram. So on these two sides, you have a non-zero correlation length. Okay. Now, when you increase the temperature, you have to compare this correlation length to the temperature. So if this is a very large number, it means that the effect of having this correlation length is negligible compared to the effect of the temperature. Okay? So this means that as you increase the temperature, the region characterized by this quantum critical point is growing. It has this form. Okay? This is called the quantum critical radial. So if you want some intuition from field theory, you can think about field theory where this is a mass parameter, for instance. So you have some massless field and you add a mass term. And this point corresponds to mass equals zero. No? Then if you are here, you are not in a scale invariant theory. But if you increase the temperature, and the temperature is much larger than the mass, at some point it behaves like a scale invariant theory. So the logic about the correlation length is the same. So this is good because it means that if you are doing experiments, you are always at finite temperature. So if you want to see the physics of the quantum critical point, it's good that this region becomes wider. It becomes accessible to the experiments. You will never be able to reach this point here. Okay, so I will say a little bit about the coal atoms, but mostly about these quantum critical points. And then, there are some interesting systems in condensed matter where you have quantum critical points. For instance, materials with heavy fermions and magnetic materials like this thing I was explaining. And also, there is a conjecture that you have this kind of quantum critical points in high TC superconductors, although this has not been proven. Okay, so in high TC there is a superconducting region around this point if you want, and then experiments observe that there is a region here where you have some exotic scaling properties of observables like the conductivity and so on. So some people propose that this behavior is due to some quantum critical point, although it cannot be observed. You cannot approach this point directly because of the superconducting phase. You would have to get rid of the superconducting phase by introducing a magnetic field, for instance. But then you are adding another axis here. No? Yes, in the superconductor, this will be doping. It's called X, usually. No? So there is some critical, maybe there is some critical doping when you have a quantum critical point, and then you can get rid of the superconducting region by adding a magnetic field, so that will be another axis. But then yeah, it's not clear what you have here, but exactly here. But the behavior looks very similar to what you expect if you have a quantum critical point. Okay, yes. Yeah, yeah, at some point there is an ultraviolet cutoff because you have a lattice and these kind of things. So if you go to really high temperatures, then all this disappears. Yeah. There is some ultraviolet cutoff implicit in all these condensed matter systems. Okay, so let's do some ADS CFT. So let me just remind you the basic about the dictionary. So we know that global symmetries. Will map to some local symmetries. Then, for instance, if we have a E1, like E1 electromagnetic, there will be some current associated to this E1, and this will map to some E1 Gates field. No, this will be the CFT part, and this will be the gravity. Also, we have space-time symmetries. We'll map to diffeomorphisms. Well, in particular, isometries of the geometry. So here, for instance, if we have let me just put the energy momentum tensor, which is the responsible for the currents associated to the symmetries, maps to the metric. And then in general, operators, like some scalar operator of dimension delta, will map to some field, which will be some scalar field. And then you have a mass in some units, which is delta times delta minus the number of dimensions. No, it's this in ADS. Yes. Well, you can generalize this to non-relativistic gravity or higher curvature gravity. But I'm going to just, in these lectures, talk about Einstein gravity coupled to matter fields to avoid some complications. Yeah. Well, that depends. It depends. It's not clear any of them describes the actual systems. So you can try to first do the simpler thing and then go to more complicated things. Yeah, well, I will have Lipschitz scaling, so or non-relativistic scaling, and then other symmetries like a relativistic boost and so on won't be there. So from the point of view of global symmetries, I will have the same global symmetries. But there is another story about particle number, which is more subtle, but I won't enter into that. Okay. Okay, so we said that we were interested in some non-relativistic scaling symmetry, this Lipschitz scaling. And then if you look at the metric of ADS, then it becomes quite clear how you can generalize, no? You need a metric that looks like this. Okay. So this will be the time coordinate, the space coordinates, and there is some radial coordinate. And I have the dynamical exponent here. So this metric has an isometry, which is this transformation together with this transformation of the radial coordinate. So you relate this isometry to the Lipschitz scaling on the dual field theory. Now, there is another kind of metric which also has this scaling symmetry, but has a few more symmetries, so this will be Lipschitz. And it takes a form like this. So now there is a new coordinate here, which is actually a null coordinate. And this coordinate rescales as well if z is different than 2 by a factor lambda to the 2 minus z. And in addition, it has boost invariance, which is non-relativistic boost invariance. So vi will be the velocity of the boost transformation. And then this null coordinate also transforms. And then if z equals 2, in addition, there is a conformal symmetry, which is non-relativistic. And then field transforms in this way. So C is the parameter of the transformation in this case. Okay. So this one is called a Schrödinger metric. Because when z equals 2, it has this non-relativistic conformal invariance, which is called Schrödinger symmetry. And this was suggested as some geometry that could describe the physics of the cold atoms. The cold atoms have the full conformal invariance. Okay, so this will be appropriate to describe cold atoms. Or fermions at unitarity. And then this one, which doesn't have any boost invariance or any conformal invariance, is usually proposed to describe these quantum critical points. Now, okay. Yeah. Yeah, I will give an example for this one. But you can get both metrics from bottom-up models of gravity coupled to matter, or even in some string theory constructions. This one usually requires some kind of TST transformations and things like that, or you do a null compactification. So, but you can get both from axioms, and I will give an example for this one. Okay, now, the boundary theory has, so the field theory dual has, is extended along the time direction and these space directions in both metrics. Well, I didn't specify the number of dimensions. Usually people take two or three space dimensions. Sorry? So far, it's not important, the number of space dimensions. Yeah, if you want to describe a cold atom system, you will take here three dimensions. And then for quantum critical points, because the systems people are interested in are effectively two-dimensional, people usually take two space dimensions for the quantum critical points, usually. And for this one, three dimensions. But you can generalize this to any dimensions. So you see here, the field theory dual lives along these directions, but you have an extra coordinate, this null coordinate. So you would like to get rid of this one. Usually you do that by compactifying and then do Kaluza-Klein reduction. But in this case, this is subtle because this is a null direction. Okay, so this is kind of an issue that, people really didn't resolve completely. So I won't talk about this in the lectures, about this kind of cold atom system. I will focus on the quantum critical point, which is simpler. Yeah. These ones? Well, in principle, there is no instability within. If you are in a bottom-up model, there is no instability. If you are in a top-down model, there is no instability in the truncation you are looking at. But of course, there could be other fields that you didn't look at. So it's not supersymmetric, so you don't know for sure if it's stable or not. So at the critical point, this geometry has the same symmetries as, sorry, this geometry has the same symmetries as, Yes, the cold atoms will live in a space with this spatial directions and time. And then when you are at the unitarity point, they have this Schrödinger symmetry, which is captured by this geometry. And then you can put this at finite density and derive things like energy density, correlators, and things like that. So, yeah. Well, the main issue is you want to do this use holographic renormalization, for instance, to derive correlators and so on. And then, in principle, at the boundary, you still have this direction. OK, so it looks like you are doing some. It has the same symmetries. That's the. No, usually they are not. So the bulk of the system of cold atoms, so far away from the walls of the trap, no, it's like you are in flat space without any potential. So this is the thing you describe with this thing. So it's just based on symmetries. But, yeah. No. It's particular for cold atoms at unitarity because in general you don't have this symmetry because interactions break it. But at the unitarity point you have this Schrödinger symmetry. Yeah. No, it can be shown. Is this thing about? Well, I can show you in private, but I want to continue with the lectures. Because I'm not going to discuss cold atoms anymore, so I can tell you in private. OK. So maybe. Here, in this system, or in this one? Well, in general, it depends on the radial coordinate, I think. So the scalar curvature, I'm not sure, but the curvature diverges at r equals 0, I think, here. There are some tidal forces that diverge. So there is some kind of singularity here. And then people have tried to think if this could be resolved in a string theory or not. But yeah. Yes. Yeah. Why does it be when it's well? Let's say there is a way to get a Schrödinger action from a null reduction of a relativistic theory. So you take Lightcon coordinates, and then you impose that you have a momentum along one of the Lightcon directions. And then if you write the let me write it here. So you'll have. This will be your relativistic field, and then you say that your relativistic field is like this. Well, these are the two Lightcon directions, and then this becomes this, which this is the Schrödinger operator, which has the Schrödinger symmetry. So this x minus is like this xi, and in fact is related to particle number symmetry. Okay, so translations along this null direction is shifting the phase of the non-relativistic field, and that's the particle number. So, okay, so let me comment on another generalization of this, which is hyperscaling violating geometries. So this is a slight modification of the Lipschitz. And what you do is you just add an overall factor. So this part inside the bracket is the same as Lipschitz. And then here, theta is the hyperscaling violating exponent. And little d is the number of space dimensions. Okay. So in this case, there is no scaling isometry. But if you do the scale transformation, then the metric transforms by a factor that depends on this theta. Okay. So the thing is, because everything is a power law here, you still will have that physical quantities depend as powers of the different scales you have, like temperature. But they won't have their canonical dimensions. There will be some anomalous dimension. And we will see later that effectively what happens is the number of space dimensions changes by this hyperscaling violating. But we will see later in an example. What time is it? Sorry, I didn't. Yeah, there is always a singularity at r equals zero. In some cases, for instance, if you have z equals one and theta negative, then you can obtain this metric from compactification from a higher dimensional ADS space. Okay, so in a case like this, you can go to higher dimensions and then the geometry is regular in higher dimensions. And this, for instance, happens if you look at p-brain metrics, black p-brain metrics. So I just wrote these metrics here based on scaling. One, before going to some action, one may ask, is anything consistent? Can I just write any dynamical exponent, a hyperscaling violating exponent that I like? So a way to put a constraint on these geometries is to study the null energy condition. Okay, in holography, this null energy condition is usually related to holographic C theorems. So it's supposed to be necessary in order to have some holographic dual, which is some unitary and causal theory. So if you have some matter, then the null energy condition tells you that for any null vector, this quantity of the energy momentum tensor in the bulk contracted with these null vectors must be positive or zero. Okay, so I haven't specified what is the matter content yet, but we can use Einstein's equations. So we assume that we will have Einstein gravity. And then we can translate this condition on the energy momentum tensor on a condition on the metric. Okay, so if you do that exercise, then you will find the following conditions. Okay, so it looks like this. So you see that if theta is equal to zero, the dynamical exponent must be larger or equal to one. And then if you want to have set smaller than one, even it could be even negative, then you need that the hyperscaling violating coefficient satisfies two conditions. Okay. If set is positive, this one implies this one, but if set is negative, it's the other way around. So you see that you cannot just write anything you want. If you write a metric that doesn't satisfy these conditions, it probably comes from matter in the bulk, which is sick in some way. Doesn't satisfy the null energy condition. In the bulk, yeah. If you have a perfect fluid, it's equivalent to having the energy density greater or equal than the pressure or the tension, if you want. So it doesn't fix the sign. If pressure is negative, energy could be negative, but it's kind of positive energy. Okay, so. Yeah. Yes, everything I'm doing is classical, so I'm assuming some kind of large limit here. So. As far as I know, in this context, no one has looked at it. Yeah. Well, it might be okay if you have this hyperscaling violating coefficient larger than the number of space dimensions. So, but I don't think many people has looked at that. They have looked at the opposite, when the dynamical exponent goes to infinity. So, because that's, maybe I will talk about that later in the another day. Okay, so let me just show an example. So a typical action that will give this kind of geometries is Einstein gravity coupled to some scalar field, which is usually called dilaton, although it has a potential, and then some gauge field. Okay, so instead of a scalar, you could have a massive gauge field, and that could also give you some Lipschitz geometry, or you could have higher dimension, higher rank forms. So if you want this theory to be, you know, under control in holography, you would like that the potential as a function of the scalar has some kind of maximum at, let's say, phi equals zero. The particular value is not important. And then this will be some, this will correspond to some ADS point. Okay, so here, If you sit at phi equals zero, the potential will be some negative constant. This will be a minus, sorry. So you have a cosmological constant, and the solution is ADS. So we'll identify this point with having an ADS space in the ultraviolet of the theory, so in the boundary. Then you can look at solutions where phi is a function of the radial coordinate, and you also have that the time component of the Gates field is non-zero, it's a function of the radial coordinate. And then you will have some kind of flow along this potential, okay? So typically, this will keep rolling on. So at some point when the potential is, when the scalar field is really very large, it's going to infinity, then there might be some terms in the potential that dominate. So you want that the term that dominates the potential has this exponential form with some coefficient delta. No? So you can approximate the potential as this thing, for instance. This will be in this region. And then also, this factor in front of the Gates field will also be approximated by some exponential. Okay? So this is a typical model. And then this phi going to infinity limit corresponds to the infrared in the field theory dual. So if you just, if you are not interested in the full RG flow, you are just interested in what's going on in the infrared, then you can just throw this part, approximate the potential by these exponentials, and see what are the solutions you have. So yes, but here this may change because you are breaking Lorentz invariance. Yes, you could also write directly this kind of action with this potential and so on. But then, to do the dictionary is more, it's not completely clear how it should work. So you know how it works for asymptotically ADS spacetimes. Although some recent works are trying to do this also for Lipschitz and so on, but it's a bit technical. So just keep in mind that we're just looking in the infrared. This is also called the near horizon geometry. And then there is an analytic solution. So I just write it as it appears in the papers. Which is a black hole solution, actually. So you can even do finite temperature. And then the dilaton is logarithmic. And the Gates field is non-zero. Okay. And then there are these alpha, beta, and gamma. Lambda here. That appear in this metric, and they are defined in terms of this delta and gamma. So the full expressions are a bit complicated, but there are some ratios which look simpler, which I give you here. Okay, lambda over alpha is 1 over gamma, and beta over alpha is delta minus gamma over 2 gamma. So you can show using this expression for the dilaton here, and doing this change of coordinates, u squared equals r to the beta minus lambda delta, that this is a hyperscaling violating geometry. Okay, sorry. So you find that the, no, so it has this form with u. And then the hyperscaling violating coefficient is given in terms of these numbers. Or you can invert this relation. Well, you can simplify using these relations, and that gives you everything in terms of gamma and delta. Okay, so given the parameters in the axiom, you get some dynamical exponent and some hyperscaling violating coefficient. Or if you want to play some game where you want to fix theta and zeta, then you just need to use this relation. So you can fix gamma and delta in terms of the hyperscaling violating coefficient and the dynamical exponent. Okay, so you have a full family of hyperscaling violating solutions that you can build with this axiom, assuming this behavior. Okay, and then there are many others. So. And well, this was bottom up, but you can find similar axioms if you do top down, no? From consistent truncations. The only thing is this potential and this factor here are fixed by the theory. There you cannot just choose anything you want. Okay. So let's do some thermodynamics. Okay, so this is, well, the first thing that one can measure and the first thing one can compute. So we have a black hole solution. As Horacio told you, this means the dual field theory is at finite temperature. And then in a CFT, the thermodynamic properties are fixed by the trace ward identity. Okay, so this means if you have a conformal field theory, the trace of the energy momentum tensor is zero in any state. Now, if we are in thermal equilibrium, and you know, rotational invariance is not broken, and translation invariance is not broken, then the expectation values of the energy momentum tensor are simply the energy density for the time component and the pressure for the space components. So if you are in the space dimensions, then this condition fixes the equation of a state to be energy density equals d times the pressure. Okay. Now, ellipses, we can do something similar. So how do we get this word identity? So it comes from the conformal invariance of the theory. So suppose we do a transformation of the coordinates in the field theory. We do an infinitesimal shift. And then if we look at the generating functional, no, which is the log of the partition function, then this partition function will change because the action will change. And if it's an infinitesimal change, it will just appear from the expansion of the exponential here. And this variation of the action can be written as the integral of the derivative of the parameter of the transformation contracted with the energy momentum tensor. Okay. So if I do a space-time transformation like this one, then the partition function changes in this way with this delta S. And then this means the generating functional changes in this way. Okay, so here we get the expectation value of the energy momentum tensor. And then if this is asymmetry, this will be zero. Okay, so for a scale transformation, the change in time, which is x0, will be x0 plus epsilon times x0, epsilon z times epsilon 0, and xi will go like xi plus epsilon xi. Okay? This is the infinitesimal version of the scale transformation. So if you plug this in here, you get the condition that set t 0 0 minus delta j t I j is equal to 0. So this is like this trace condition for the CFT, but now the dynamical exponent appears here. And this implies that the thermodynamic equation of a state is very similar to the conformal theory, but you get the dynamical exponent. So from here, if you just have temperatures, you can deduce the dependence on the temperature from these thermodynamic relations. Energy plus pressure equals temperature times entropy, and the entropy is the variation of the pressure with respect to temperature. So you get, using this equation of a state, a differential equation for the pressure. That you can integrate immediately and tells you that the temperature goes like d plus z over z. And then from here you can also get the entropy, right? Just taking the variation with respect to the temperature. And you can also get something that I call Vs squared, which is the variation of the pressure with respect to the energy density. And this you can also write as entropy over a specific heat. So if you take this derivative, you see that this is set over D. In the relativistic theory, this will be the speed of sound. In the non-relativistic theory, the speed is dimensionful. Okay? So the speed will depend on the density or the temperature. So this cannot be interpreted directly as the speed of sound, but it tells you something about the stiffness of the system, how easy it is to compress it or not. If you set C to zero, it will mean that the pressure has to be zero. No? I think pressure equals zero is like a Hagedorn state, if I remember correctly. No, like in a Hagedorn state, the energy density equals T times S. So maybe set equals zero is like a Hagedorn state. But I'm not sure. Now, this argument I use here, you can just get the same result using scaling arguments. So if space derivatives have dimension one, time derivatives will have dimension set, and then temperature will have dimension set. And then Tij couples to the metric, which is dimensionless. So you will have dt, ddx, gij, Tij. So this is dimensionless. This part will have dimension minus z minus d, and it has to be compensated by the dimension of the stress tensor. So the pressure has dimension d plus z. Okay, and then if the temperature is the only dimensionful quantity, then this dependence follows just from scaling arguments. Now, this is good if we have pure Lipschitz. If we have hyperscaling violation, then from the field theory perspective, it's a bit difficult to know, you know, what will happen, because the modification of the trace word identity doesn't make it obvious what the equation of the state should be. So in general, if you have hyperscaling violation, it means you broke conformal invariance by adding some operators that are not marginal. No? You will have some set of operators, OA, that break scaling invariance. And then the general formula for the trace word identity should be modified to something like this, where you have here the beta functions for these guys. So just by looking at this, it's not obvious what these beta functions, this expectation value, et cetera, is. So it's not obvious what the equation of a state will be. But from the black hole metric, you can deduce this in holography at least. No? So let me write the black hole metric now. Okay, so as Horacio told you, there is a change of coordinates where you can make this metric look like flat space. Let me write it explicitly. So this is R equals RH times 1 plus some constant rho squared over 2. And then we expand for rho much smaller than 1. Yeah. 10 minutes? Ah, time is over. Okay, let me just give you the result, and that will be it. So the temperature, you can just do it as an exercise, goes like RH to the set. And then the entropy, which is the entropy density, which is the area over 40 Newton. This goes like RH to the D minus theta. So that tells you that the entropy goes like T to the D minus theta over Z. And the pressure, of course, goes like D plus Z minus theta over Z, and so on. So by looking at this, you see that the effect of the hyperscaling violating exponent is that the effective number of dimensions is D minus theta, as I was telling you before. And well, since I'm over time, I will stop here. Yes. No, as you have to rotate to, I didn't have time to say it, but you rotate to the equilibrium. And then. Yes. You use Minkowski. Yes. Because the metric has the signature of Minkowski. Yeah, this has the signature of Minkowski. So the leaf sits is not conformal. Is yeah, yes. E square, yeah. So no, but this is an identity in the field theory dual where the metric is flat. The metric is just the Minkowski metric in the field theory dual. When U is 1. Sorry, I'm not sure what is the question. Well, as I said before, this is the infrared geometry. So if you keep going away from the horizon, you will find ADS. So that was the implicit assumption. And this derivation is done only in the field theory dual, where you assume from the beginning that you have Minkowski.